I often find that marshalling of facts is the first important thing. Law evolves on the facts. And therefore, the nitty-gritty of facts must be taken care of. And then how the law should apply to it. So, if there's deficiency in either or two situations, it's a problem. And of course, then comes the third aspect, which is the presentation of the facts and the law. You should be decent in your presentation. I think people distinguish between being shouting at the top of the voice and making a point. So, if you are making your point firmly and forcefully, it's never an offensive. But there is a thin line sometimes between what can be offensive and what can be a pleasant way of putting your point of view forward. What you think is your strongest point, begin after setting out the fact in relation thereto. And then develop the law on that. See, we have two stages of litigation. The first is what I call the admission matter, that you are making out a case that, look, this is a case fit enough for notice. That's a case where the arguments are not going to last for a long period of time. And therefore, in a short time, you have to convey your point of view. While in a final hearing case, you have more time at hand to set forth your facts and law. So you have to get to and think on your feet what is that may appeal to a judge at the initial stage to get a notice issued. And sometimes the judge may take up something completely different from what you have thought. That's why I keep emphasizing the ability to think on your feet is that if the judge's mind is going elsewhere, you can't say, look, I want this to go in this direction only. You have to meet what the judge wants, because if the judge's mind is on that point, he is not going to listen to what you are saying. For an admission hearing, written submission is not important, really. But for final hearing, I think setting forth a short synopsis helps both the lawyer and the judge to focus on the mainstream of the matter. And then how you develop on that is a skill which you evolve. Well, firstly, answer them. I think that's the first point. Often there is a tendency to brush aside the question or presume that the judge is against us because he's posing the question. It's only the inquisitiveness of the mind of the judge who tries to clarify some doubts. So the most important thing is to give an answer to it. If there is no answer, say so there is no answer. It's better than going here and there. Well, he asks you a question. If you don't know, I'm sure he'll accommodate you if you say, I would like to look into this matter further. Though one should expect that in an area where you're arguing, you should be fully familiar. But then the area is so wide at times you may not know. But to filibuster creates its own problems. Oration skills are important. It's how you're able to convey it. There has to be a command over the language for it. There has to be a clarity of thought process for it. And the oratorial skills then depend on these two aspects. See, we are in an era where we have inundation of precedents. And therefore, just making compilation and trying to throw them at the judge is not helping, I think. So you take out your best precedents and say, and if the judge really wants something more, you can set out. Because ultimately, if there's a doubt in the mind of the judge, you are setting a precedent. If the judge already knows that precedent, then he'll take care of it. I think it does, depending on how you are presenting it. Mr. Nani Palkiwala was one of the greatest lawyers and presenter, and he used to take things out of the ordinary and put them before the judge for him to explain how it will work in real life. Trying to say something which is not borne out from the record, because if a lawyer gets caught once with false fact, it's very difficult for the judge to trust him in the next time. So be at least honest to the court. Well, often how the phraseology used is, they say, well, I have not made myself clear. And at least I tell them that when I've understood it and I'm not agreeing with them, I tell them that clarity is neither a problem with you or with me. But maybe I don't agree with you. I don't think seniority alone matters. I think there are some there are young people who have done exceedingly well, I think, at a young age. And it is by dint of their hard work, by the honesty which they portray, the judges form an opinion. And once the initial opinion is good, I think the evolution is quicker. simple apology is enough. Let me tell you, a judge doesn't carry things into his chamber. He's not expected to carry things into the chamber. Sometimes it may happen that a little heat is generated. A judge is human, he may lose a little temper. Lawyer is human, he may lose a little temper. It should cool down quickly. That's how I believe. Well, telling him so or reading out the precedent to him. Judge is not supposed to be, and I don't think, a closed mind. We every day debate in ourselves. We take decisions, we debate in our mind whether to go one way or the other. So it's a constant process of coming to conclusions. So, and the areas of law are so wide today that I think no judge or lawyer can claim an absolute mastery over any area of law. I think one of the first mistakes is to not marshal your facts. The second mistake I would say is not answer the judge. And the third mistake is to try to filibuster. Civil law or hardcore criminal cases, the technical pleas are important at times because in civil cases they can non-suit a claimant, for example, limitation. Similarly, in criminal cases where just creating a benefit of doubt is sufficient. So I've seen a senior counsel argue before me who, while presenting the case, said something, and one of the judges remarked, "Well, that's a possibility." He said, "That's all I need to prove. If there are two possibilities, I succeed." These are arts of, you know, managing these two kind of litigations. But in larger issues, like where social norms are involved, with public interest litigations are involved, the court takes a more liberal view of the matter to come to a conclusion. Judgment going for or against is a daily existence of a lawyer. It's not necessary that the lawyer was wrong, nor necessary the judge is wrong. I believe ultimately it is an opinion which a judge gives. So a single judge is overruled by a division bench. The Supreme Court may say something, and it's what Supreme Court says is the final word only because it's the last court. So I always believe there was court above the Supreme Court. Maybe even our orders would be set aside. It's a debate, and I think people must understand in this debate, the debate can go one way or the other. I won't say anything specific, but I think if people maintain a sense of humor in times, it's greatly useful. I do believe that we keep talking about the British sense of humor, and that's something which was worth imbibing from the British.